should tell us to get out of the house, and then should tell us to get out of the yard, and then should lock her gate. And then being naked in the street at night around 7, 8, and then would run to the bush. There was a bush in front of our home then, and then would run into the bush. And then my mother would be shouting, "There are baboons, there are baboons throwing stones at us." And then, you know, we'll go into the bush, hide. I don't know why the neighbors or the people around would not come out of the houses to look or check on these baboons which are in the location. So we'd be there the whole night, the whole evening. And then when we see now the lights are off at home, when she's sleeping, we'll jump the gate and come into the yard and would sleep in the toilet. The toilet was outside the house. So we'd sleep in the toilet for the whole night naked. Hi. My name is Thelma Dlamini. I'm currently staying at Protea North, Soweto. I was born and bred up in Mdeni, still Soweto. I am second child of my parents, which are both no more. And I've got five siblings. Growing up, my mother was married to a Zulu man. She was Tswana. And after marriage, having married at an older age, she could not have children. And that became an issue to her in-laws as she was staying with them right in Ngqutu. And then they were calling her a crawl, a man in the crawl. And then that sat not well with her. So they struggled for a long time until such time that someone told her that she has to buy presents, those gifts which are bought by a person when getting into a family as a bride. And then she did that. Nothing happened. They continued waiting. And then after some time, my father remembered that as he was growing up, he was once kicked by a cow on the groin, and then he had a swelling on the groin. And then he was advised to go seek medical help. And then he went for medical help. And then they told him that there was a clot. And then the clot was evacuated, and then after they could conceive. So my mother was labeled wrong to say she was barren, whereas the problem was with the husband, who was my father then. They were happy. They had a baby boy. And then you can imagine, after we've not been having children for a long time, now suddenly you have this boy and you are happy, you're holding this boy, you are breastfeeding. Mothers will know how good it is and how wonderful it is to breastfeed the baby for the first time. She was breastfeeding this baby. And you know, while we were growing up, we used to enjoy hanging nappies on the line. She did all that. Unfortunately, the child passed on. That thing was taken away from her. She had another baby, a baby girl. And then now having this baby girl, she was happy. She said the child was Matsidiso, meaning the child came to bring comfort to her. And then the elders told her, no, you can't say she's comfort. She has to be Hohonyane, which is a little monster. And the child grew up, she's still alive up to today. And then later she had another boy. So the boy did not live also. So then after, my mother and my father continued until they had the other six children. So now they were happy, they were bringing up the children together as a couple. And then the shame has been taken away. My mother was happy to have children like any other Magodi within the Ngqutu Zulu family. And then growing up, and my mother and father, they were renting in different houses. We had to move from one house to another, one house to another, until finally they got a house at Mdeni, where I was brought up. And then when she was there, the area was meant for the Zulu speaking people. So because our surname was Zulu, which is Mhlungu, so we stayed at Mdeni. And then the neighborhood was comprising of Zulu speaking people. So my mother was not treated well because she was Tswana and she could not express herself in Zulu. And then there's this woman with her children who would stand at the corner when my mother came back to work, they would beat her up, they would insult her. For her, even going out of the house to go to the toilet or whatever, it was a mission, because she was thinking, if I could see these people outside, they would say something to her. Obviously, most of the things she did not even understand. But she lived, and then until such time, after the beatings, now and then she was beaten up. I remember one day when she was going to work, she woke us up in the morning so that we can prepare ourselves for school. And then as she was, after a few minutes, she came back. And then when she came back, she said, I've been injured. And then she took off her head cover. And then there was a wound bleeding. So as children, we tried to clean her up. And then she was fine. And then as time went on, she went back, she went to work. So we're at home as children. Now we are starting to become scared also as children that what if we are also being attacked? So that's how her life was in the area. She was not free. And then being the only one speaking Tswana in the house, because even as her children were speaking Zulu, it's only my big sister would speak Tswana to her at sometimes. So she was not happy. I remember growing up in that place, at some stage, she was called. She was still bathing in the house, and then she was called to go outside because my brother was fighting with another boy. And then when she went out, she tried to separate the boys. As she was separating the boys, the mother of the other boy came and started beating her up. And then she fell. She did not have her underwear on. They laughed at her. The children came laughing at her. And then a lot of things happened to her. And now my father also changed her attitude towards my mother. She was not taking care of us. She had no time for my mother. And then at some stage, my father left my mother to stay with another woman in the area. The lady had a shipping. So my father was staying with her there. So my mother was so frustrated. And then with everything that happened, she never received any counseling. She was just moving on as if there's nothing that had happened. Losing children and everything, she just had to move on. My father left her, she had to move on. She was called names by the in-laws, she had to move on. So she had this pain that was inside of her, but she kept us happy in the house. We used to be a happy family. She would tell us bedtime stories. Would be happy to have her in the house. But as time went on, with everything that was happening to her, she started changing. Her character changed. We did not know the mother that we were having now in the house. We were so scared of her. She used to shout at us. She used to beat us with anything that she would find. And then when there's anything broken in the house, if, for instance, she finds a car broken, she would ask us who broke this car. And then would say, we don't know. And they should pick one of us to say, it's you. And then whoever who has been picked up should beat that person up, with all her strength, with all her might. She would even kneel on the head of the child. And then she would beat the child with a metal part of the strap. The strap is a thick leather belt which was used for tying the suitcase. She would use that for beating us. And then the child would be saying, she would be asking who broke the car, for instance. The child would be saying, no, I don't know. She would beat the child to say, you are speaking lies. The beatings would be more and more as long as they said they did not know. Until as a child, she would decide to say, rather let me say it's me. When you start saying that it's me, then you'll be beaten up to say you were speaking lies. Why did you lie at first? So the beatings will go on and on and on and on. So I remember there's this little brother of mine who was picked up to say he stole my mother's mother's money. And then my mother beat him up. He beat him up for so long. We're all scared until at some stage he could not cry. So the man from next door came to say, it's enough now. I've been listening to the child crying. I think it's enough. You've beaten him. It's enough. Now stop, please. And then she decided to stop. And then after stopping, my mother, my brother could not sit because of the pain, because of the scars on his body. So we had to go on like that. And then after beating up a child, could be shouting at the child until we go to sleep. And then in the morning, early morning hours, around 3 to should wake up. As soon as she wakes up, she loses her sleep. She starts shouting until every child is up, but will be hiding under the blanket so that she does not see that we are up. So she used to do that. And then now, because as I said that, my father decided to do his own things. He managed his pain in his own way, in his funny way. So my mother became angry towards my father also. So my father was sleeping in his bedroom alone. The house we're in, it was a two-bedroomed house. So my father had his own bedroom, which was cemented, no tile, no carpet, nothing. And there was a bed without a mattress. We had old clothes on the mattress, on the spring. My father was sleeping on that. And then my father used to drink a lot then. And then after drinking, when he's sleeping, he would pass urine on the bed, would spit sputum on the floor in saliva. And then the bedroom was very filthy. And then during sleep, at some nights, he would have this sound. He would have this sound that came from his bedroom, from him. And then my mother would run to his bedroom. And then after that sound, the mattress would shake like someone is shaking. So my mother would go to the bedroom then. And then while my mother was there, would feel as if my father was being strangled. So that happened for a long time. And then sometimes there's a time when my mother wanted my father to go to die. So would grind bottles and put in my father's food. So he would put the rat poison, the rat tex then. So put it in the food, my father's food. He would put bleach in my father's food. But my father just became okay. Nothing happened to him. But as a child, I was just looking at this and I was not happy. And I used to like to love my father because my father was very quiet. He would not talk, would just keep quiet. Even if you say something to him, it would just be one word answer. So I loved my father so much and I was my father's favorite girl. So he even had a name that he called me. He used to say, I'm Nkeleza. So I loved everything about him. So my father never died. I remember my mother used to beat my father up. So my father would just like, you know, protect himself from whatever my mother was using to beat him up. And then there's this other day, my father was working. It was a Saturday morning, so he went to work. So he used to walk a 1 hour distance going to the train station. So I think he left very early. So he came back at around past 5 or whatever. So there was a knock at the door. We were still sleeping, all of us with my mother. So when the knock was on the door, so we woke up to find out, who is it? So my father said, it's me. So my mother said, don't open for him. So like, you know, I was not happy. So my father said, no, I've been beaten up. My mother said, no, don't open. So go back to sleep. So we had to go back to sleep. So my father had to go to our next door. So now when I woke up around 6 a.m., I went straight to our next door neighbor to check if my father was there. Fortunately, I found him there. The man who had made fire on the stove, the coal, we were using coal then. So my father was sitting around the stove. It was warm in the house. He was drinking tea, hot tea. The lips were so swollen and the face was so swollen and the scratches on the face and everything. I was so heartbroken. So like seeing my father like that and knowing that he came to his house, he was not allowed permission into his house because my mother tended to be someone else. She tended to be so bitter. She was bitter with everybody. The brother who comes after me was 1 year, 3 months younger than me. Remember, my mother had to give birth of children like close to one another. So he was drunk that particular day. So he was in the kitchen sitting, talking, because he was also shy. He would only talk when he's drunk. So mother was so irritated with her, told her to stop talking. And then unfortunately he vomited on the floor. My mother told him to clean. So he did not clean up the vomit. So then my mother said to him, you know what? I am going to be called one day. You'll be lying there on the street dead. So people will come and call me to say, come and pick the body of your child. So I kept those words in my mouth. I had that thing as a child. I used to keep words in my heart. I kept them to say these words are not good words. And with my mother, everything that she said, it used to happen exactly the way she said it. Even with my big sister, they had paid Lola for her. She was about to go and sign. And then at the Home Affairs offices. So she was standing on the ladder in the kitchen painting. So my mother was shouting at her like that. And then my mother said to her, you know what? That marriage is not going to last. And surely my sister got married at the age of 19. At 21 years, she was divorced. I remembered those words. And then after I got married, a few years after I got married, my firstborn was about 4 years. My brother came to my place in the morning on a Monday morning to call me. So he said to me, my brother is dead. He's been shot the previous night. My mother's words came back to me to say, this is what she has said. It has happened exactly. She was called to say, your son is dead on the street. So I was like, with everything that was happening, I was like, I had that bitterness and anger in my heart when things happened. I remember when I went home after receiving the news of my brother who was dead, I told myself that I'm going to remind her that these are the words that you said, be happy. But by the grace of God, I never said anything when I arrived home, because I know now I would be regretting that. So I remember growing up, as I said, that my mother would punish us. I remember when my big sister would do something wrong, as the big one in the house, everyone had to be punished in the house. And then when she's wrong, she's done something wrong, we would be called, all of us, and then she would tell us that your sister did 1, 2, 3, therefore everyone is down for punishment. And then she used to make us to take off her clothes, everything that we wore, because she was the one doing everything for us. Would take off her clothes, would be naked. All of us, the children in the house, would be naked. And then she'd lock herself. She would leave us in the kitchen and lock herself in the other rooms that side. And my father, remember, she would just be quiet as if he's not even there. Would sleep in the kitchen, naked, the whole night. There's this other morning when she came from the bedroom, when she woke up, she found one of my sisters with a woolen hat on her head. She grabbed the hat with this anger to say, why are you wearing my hat? So we were so scared, we pushed each other towards the corner of the stove, running away from it because we did not know what would come next. Sometimes after making us to take off her clothes, she'd tell us to get out of the house and then she'd tell us to get out of the yard and then she'd lock her gate. And then being naked in the street at night around 7, 8, and then we'd run to the bush. There was a bush in front of our home then we'd run into the bush, and then my mother would be shouting, there are baboons throwing stones at us. And then, you know, we'll go into the bush, hide. I don't know why the neighbors or the people around would not come out of the houses to look or check on these baboons which are in the location. So we'd be there the whole night, the whole evening. And then when we see now the lights are off at home, when she's sleeping, we'll jump the gate and come into the yard and would sleep in the toilet. The toilet was outside the house. So we'd sleep in the toilet for the whole night naked. And then in the morning, before she wakes up, we would make sure that we go out of the yard, because now we'd know that it would be something. So we'd go out of the house, of the yard, and then we used to steal the cloth that we used for cleaning. So because always when we were sleeping outside like that, in the morning she would call my big sister to say, come, and then she'd send her to the shops in her nakedness. And then she would, when mom goes into the house, she would wrap that cloth around her waist and go to the shop and buy whatever, and then she'll come back and then she'll come and pick whatever from the gate, and then after some time she'll open for us and we'll be given our clothes and everything. It used to make us feel that pain. I remember me as a young girl, remember at home we used to be quiet. So there's a time when I felt, no, I'm tired of this quietness. I would like try to speak in the house so that everybody should be happy and smile. And then when I started that, my mother thought I had a boyfriend now, because now I was becoming someone else. So she asked me, do you have a boyfriend? I said, no, I was not into boys. And I was like, I took time to be clever in the area of having affairs and whatever. So she took me to the clinic one morning. She told me the previous day that tomorrow we are going to the clinic. I thought she was going to ask the doctors or the nurses to check if I was pregnant. I was actually excited to say she will be disappointed because there was nothing. And then we went there. On the way, we were not talking to one another. We reached the clinic, and then on reaching the clinic, we went to the room where we were supposed to go. She spoke to the doctor privately. I was sitting there. So fortunately, I saw one of the girls from the area where I'm staying. We just greeted one another. And then my turn to go in came. I went into the consulting room. So the doctor told me to climb into the examination couch. I climbed, okay, to take off my underwear. And then she said I should climb. So the position that she said I should adopt, it made me so uncomfortable. Most of it was a male doctor. And then I did that because we were not allowed to be rude to adults. So I felt this discomfort as she was doing whatever to me. And then after we went home, she told me, the doctor told me how to check this thing which is inside of me, if it was in place. But now before he did that, when he started working on me, he said, I don't like doing this to children. I didn't understand. Remember, I was young. I did not know anything about hymen and what. That time, I think I was about 16 years. And my menarche started very late. So I was about 16 years. So like, that was that. The thing was inside of me. She gave me the instructions on how to check if it was in situ. That was fine. And then going back home, I was very angry. And then later in the afternoon, I went to look for that girl. And then I asked her questions. She answered all the questions. She was happy to say that now I know I'm free. I won't be pregnant with this thing in me. I said, So it means this thing was to protect me from pregnancy. When I learned later in life that the doctor, when he said, I don't like doing this to children like this, he meant cutting the hymen. So I was so angry. I said, I wish I could have broken my hymen. My virginity, with my knowing what I'm doing, not because of someone's insecurities. After some time, I asked her after 2 years, I asked her if you could go and remove this thing. She said, I can't, because she has to sign for it to be removed. I pleaded with her for a long time until there's a day when she decided, okay, let me write a letter, because I asked for a letter. She wrote a letter. To my surprise, when I went there, they never asked for a letter. They just removed it and they gave me the oral contraceptives. They told me how to take them. Going back home, when I arrived at home, I just took the oral contraceptive. I threw them in front of my mother. I said, there, you have them. I don't need them. And then in the process, when I had this intrauterine device inside of me, I was raped. And to me, because of anger, I thought my mother is the one who made these people to rape me. She made me to put this thing. That is, this is what attracted these rapists to me. So I grew up being that angry girl. At some stage, my mother wanted me to get married to this other older man who was about more than 50 years. I was very young. I had not started seeing my menses then. I was about 15. He wanted me to get married to this man. So I just became surprised. This one Saturday, she became so nice to me. She called me, let's sit down, let's talk. Only to find that she told me she wants me to get married to this man who used to come home every weekend. And I used to accompany him. My mother would say I should accompany him to the taxi rank when he went back home. So only to realize that I was supposed to get married to the man. So I told my mother on the spot to say, you know what? I'm not getting married to this man. I wrote a book regarding this. But now, my message in the book, I wrote the book as a healed person now. It's not like giving people pain. All I'm encouraging people to do, whenever you pass through whatever negative situation, uncomfortable circumstances, any pain, it's so important to go for counseling. My mother never received any form of counseling. She passed through a lot of things. She was so broken, very broken. So it's so important for us to seek counseling. I know with men, most of the time they say they don't need counseling. They don't like talking about issues, but it's important because what happens now, if you don't receive counseling, you become angry, you give other people pain. You become bitter, and then you give people bitterness. You hate those around you. Mostly you hate the people that love you. So it's so important to receive counseling, and God is able to give you a new character. In fact, because of counseling, you become a vessel that God can use to help others who've been through the pain that you went through because you have been healed. But without healing, there's no way that will help others. There's no way that people will be happy to be around you because of the pain that you went through. So it's important. So the book that I wrote is this one, Brokenness and Raising Children. So I realized that there are many families which are dysfunctional like mine. And in the process, the children are receiving pain, they are hurt, they become bitter. And as a mother, I did not give my children the love I was supposed to give them because of the pain, because I could not give what I don't have. So my plea to everyone who's listening to say, please seek counseling. Local clinics have got social workers. If you don't have money for a psychologist or whatever, you can receive counseling. Just say that I need a counselor. And as community members, when you see another family that is passing through those hard times, so it is a duty of each and everyone as people living within the community to refer. It can be anonymously, but as long as the people are referred so that they receive help, it is so important. Hi, my name is Thelma Dlamini. I've been through the most.